So, the great Henrik Fisker, tell us a little bit about this Ocean vehicle you're debuting here at CES.
Well, you know, it's our electric SUV that we start delivering this year in November. It's got the world's longest range in its class, up to 350 miles. It's got amazing powertrain with up to 550 horsepower, four-wheel drive, torque vectoring, 0 to 60 in 3.9 seconds, so it's super fun to drive. I actually took it out in the desert, took it up to over 100 miles an hour, a lot of fun. But the whole idea here was, how can we mix sports car design with SUV design? So we did a lot of cool stuff, like really wide track, large 22-inch wheels. You can also get 20-inch wheels if you want to go a little more off-road. But the design was very important for me to really get this sort of sports car feeling into an SUV, which nobody's really done before.
Now, you're talking about the design, and there's a lot of very creative things about this particular design. First of all, you and your partner, Magnus Steyer, you're using sustainable products for your interior. It's all vegan. Talk about that. What made you think about that in design?
Well, you know, Magnus is our contract manufacturer. So what's very important there is, of course, that we can source all the things and they can build the things for us. But we've designed the interior specifically with sustainability in mind. So not only do we have the entire interior being vegan, but we use carpets that's made from recycled plastic bottles. Some of the materials are using recycled t-shirts, for example. So everything is super sustainable. Even on the exterior, we're actually using recycled carbon fiber as part of the wheel. So sustainability is a big deal for this vehicle. We anticipate this vehicle could be the world's most sustainable vehicle.
And you even have solar panels on the roof. Talk about that.
We've got solar panels on the roof, and that can give you up to 2,000 miles a year. Nobody has really done solar panels where you actually can charge a high voltage battery. So we can do this with this vehicle. We had to invent a special converter to be able to do that. But it's super cool to have this. It also has the largest open roof in the world, or at least one of them. When you look from inside, you can see it's huge.
Now, we have a concept that we use for our students, which is superhero rap, which talks about idealism, which is your ideal self and the ideal world you want to live in. So speak about your ideal vision, because you're using a lot of sustainability, and that's actually carrying into a mass manufactured product. Talk about your own idealism and what you envision transportation and mobility to be.
Well, you know, for me, ideally, we would like to make a completely climate neutral vehicle in terms of how it's produced, how it's made, all the materials. We have set our goal to do that by 2027. It's a tough goal, but we're working towards it. This is the first step in this direction. You know, it costs more, of course, to put a solar roof on. It costs more to put, you know, sustainable materials inside the vehicle, but it's worth it. And for me, the ideal is to be in the future, can drive around in fully emission-free and sustainable and CO2-neutral vehicles, because that way they could be a great part of our society of the future without any pollution, and that's what we all want.
Well, you're an exceptional businessman. This is your second start again. We're doing your own vehicle. We spoke with your last vehicle, with the Fisker, which the design you did over a decade ago is still breathtaking today. So what were some of the lessons learned? And in this approach, you went SPAC. Well, you go in contract manufacturing. What were some of the lessons learned?
I think contract manufacturing is a part of it, but the other part of it is raising enough money to begin with. And that's very difficult if you try to do it privately, so we went public. We have, in the meantime, raised $1.6 billion. And then also having very reliable suppliers. So, for example, we made a great deal with the world's largest battery supplier. That's very important. Of course, the contract manufacturing with Magna, having a company that you know is going to deliver high-quality vehicles right out of the gate. That's much more difficult if you try to build your own factory and think you can build as good cars as somebody like Magna, which have done it for decades. They're building BMWs, Toyotas, Mercedeses, so we know we're going to get a high-quality car, so that's very important as well.
Now, you also have another large partner, Foxconn, and that concept is something very novel. You're going to be building the future of mobility. So talk about your designing and thinking about how do you look at mobility to be different than just a four-wheeled transportational vehicle?
Well, you know, what we're doing with Foxconn is a very radical mobility concept, so it's not another car really. Of course, it will be a car in terms of having four wheels and drive, but we are thinking of this project in a different way. We didn't start out by saying, hey, we're going to make a vehicle that it's going to be in this category. We started off by using user scenarios, specifically of young people in big cities. How do they live? What do they need? What type of mobility do they need? And how would they use this mobility? What do they put it into? How do they go about it? So we created this very unique mobility concept. There's going to be a car called the PEAR, and it stands for Personal Automotive Electric Revolution. Personal Electric Automotive Revolution. And the idea is to really come out with something for the future. So it's going to look like a sexy spaceship. It's going to be completely different. It doesn't have either a normal trunk or a normal hatch. So we have a lot of innovative features on this vehicle. It'll come out in 2024. We probably won't show it until then because it's so radical. We don't want to give any of that away to our competitors.
So now, speaking about that, and again, on our concept, Superhero Rap, our students develop themselves as superhero characters, and we teach them 3D modeling and design. But superheroes also need their vehicle. So what are some of the things you're thinking about when you're saying that it will look like a spaceship? How can you envision students in this vehicle?
I think the way I think about a spaceship, when I refer to that, I mean the sense of a super futuristic shape, futuristic technology, like, for example, the lighting. We're looking at some new lighting technologies to put into this vehicle. In the interior, we're going to have some new cool features. What's interesting about this vehicle is it's going to start under $30,000. So it's a challenge to make something super cool for that price. And that's what we're working on right now. I think in terms of being a superhero, you know, it's all about trying to do something extraordinary, right? You're going out of your way to create something and helping others. That's what superhero does. And in this case, we're trying to figure out how can we help everybody to live in a cleaner world. And that's why the goal is to make the world's most sustainable vehicles.
And now this vehicle would also be produced in a repurposed factory that used to be where GM manufactured the Cruze, in Lordstown. So talk about that.
Yeah, I think, you know, our first factory in Magna is a CO2 neutral factory already run by Hydro. And the repurposed factory that Foxconn have just bought in Ohio, again, is sustainability. We don't have to build a new factory. But what's cool about this factory is it's one of the largest in the world. It can make about 500,000 vehicles a year. So hopefully we are really successful and we can jam every single car out of there from us. It would be a lot of fun.
Yes, and then now, so in this venture, your wife is actually a partner. Speak about that.
Yeah,
and the dynamics of having your wife with you, who's very exceptional in her own right, very qualified. And how is that in sound, having your partner sound off with you?
Yeah, you know, we are two very different personalities in terms of what we concentrate. I'm very creative, concentrating on the development, the creative, the PR, the marketing. She is very mathematical. She comes from financial background. She is a CFO and the chief operating officer. So under her is everything to do with operations, HR, IT, finance. So it's worked really well. I mean, it probably can be difficult, but in our case, it's working really well. And the good news is we can kind of work 18 hours a day, but still see each other.
Yes.
If you work 18 hours a day and your partner does something else, it's very rare you get to see each other. We work 7 days a week too.
So that helps the relationship too.
That helps the relationship for sure.
So as far as thinking about the future, what kind of tools can you envision that will get people prepared to be able to work with Fisker in the future, well, as far as design tools and exposure?
Well, I think you got to go to a recognized design school in automotive design. You got to have that degree. You got to have to spend some time, I would say, in 3D modeling in clay in small scale models to understand surfacing, to understand the three dimensions, because, you know, the car is probably one of the most complicated shapes because it has to work in three dimensions. You know, you look at the car from this angle, you walk around, the highlight has to work. You're looking at the proportions, you know, in terms of the tail latch, you know, in terms of the wheels to the body relation, the relation of the windows. All this is to do with proportions, and it takes a long time to get a good eye for that. You're going to have some talent for it as well. But if you spend a lot of time on it, really try to understand proportions, even looking at some of the older vehicles that got very famous, like a Jaguar E-Type, or why is it so famous? What is it with the proportions of this car that made it such a beautiful looking car? One of the most difficult things for designers is to actually be more minimalistic. We all love to put a lot of ideas into one car, but the real, I think, essence of good design, apart from the proportions, is to be able to actually clean up your own design, step back, be tough on yourself and don't overdo the design with too many lines and too many things. And then you find the harmony, that perfect harmony between the different graphics as well, how they line up with each other. So there's many things that might take some years to learn, but the start is you got to go to a really good design school. You got to be able to translate your ideas within your head onto a piece of paper and into three dimensions.
And then my other question too is that, so as mobility changes, what other skills should people look at in their design?
Well, I think, you know, yes, mobility are changing, but I think a good designer is a good designer. And we can adapt whether you're making a vehicle that is going to be used as a ride-hailing, ride-sharing, an autonomous vehicle. You know, we aren't going to have cars for personal, for private people without steering wheels for many, many years. That was a little bit of a quick fad, and now it's sort of gone off again. So we still need to design a car where people are sitting in it, interacting with it. There's a big difference between exterior design and interior design. Normally you choose either of the two because there's two very different ways of designing. The exterior is all about that initial wow factor and then the long-lasting timeless design. The interior is very involved into ergonomics. It's a multiple, it's a really a design which have multiple product parts in it that all needs to fit together, so it's a lot more complex.
So now talk about autonomous, because you just kind of hinted on that. What kind of autonomous features, and how do you see the timeline and integrating level 3 or level 4?
So we don't look at it at levels. And I think level 5, we are 10 years or more away from having that. And that's a fully autonomous vehicle that can drive itself in any condition. We may even be more than 10 years. We may never have it. Now, in terms of autonomous features, what we have decided is we really want to focus on the safety aspect. So today we're showing, for example, that we will have the world's first digital radar, 4D radar, in our vehicle and standard in all our vehicles. And what that does is it sees much better through heavy rain. It sees better, for example, if you're driving a tunnel in New York or in Europe, through, you know, tunnels in the mountains, etc. So it enhances the safety for these extreme situations that we hope we never incur, but when you do, the autonomous system can fail. So in this case, we're enhancing that. We'll be the first in the world to have that digital radar, and that will enable us to enhance the safety around, you know, our autonomous features.
So is that going to be available on the Ocean and the new vehicle?
Yes.
Wow. So you're debuting that, which is 3D, to be able to see through inclement, which also is part of what causes
4D.
4D.
So it actually, in several, it can see radars today and cameras. They have a difficulty in, for example, distinguishing between a bicycle or a motorcycle, or between a person and a large animal. In this case, we can do this distinction much better with this digital radar, and we are showing it over here. You know, in our platform here. So we are showing these radars that you see over here, the big black boxes. There's 5 of them in the vehicle.
Wow. So in conclusion, what would you say to inspire the next generation of designers?
Well, I think in my world, I think what's really inspiring is if young people can come up with the next generation of super sustainable vehicles which still looks good. You know, we had this issue with electric cars when they first came out. They kind of looked doughy and dorky.
Yes.
And nobody wants to drive a dorky car. So whenever you think about a new futuristic design, it needs to look good. It needs to be exciting. It needs to be better than what we have today.
Thank you so much, Henrik.